everyone. I am the Manic Number 3, and today I'm going to be introducing you to Evan McMillan, the Trapper. The Trapper is a unique killer, and in my opinion, requires the most mount knowledge and practice than any other killer. If you're looking for a one-shot, end-all, be-all guide for the Trapper, you're never going to find it. Unlike other killers, Trapper's ability to play the map is solely reflected on how the player is able to identify situations quickly and play the map and adapt to all situations. It can even have a small bit of luck involved, and timing is key. But what I will do here is give you a few Trapper tips to help you on your way. Okay, so this guide is going to cover a few different things. First, the Trapper's basic attributes and the way his power works. The Trapper's teachable perks. A couple builds with and without teachables. Addons and offerings. Maps and loops. How and where to place traps in certain tiles, and making the most use of your territory. Alright, let's talk about the Trapper's power. When the Trapper spawns, they have a bear trap in their hand that they can place anywhere they wish on the ground of the map, by traveling to that destination and placing it. There are also an additional fire traps located around the map that the Trapper can pick up and place in a similar manner. By default, Trapper can only carry one trap at a time, and the time to set a trap is about 2.5 seconds. But when a trap is placed is when things actually get tricky. If a survivor steps in a trap, they are trapped at that location until they are freed from the trap. If they were healthy, they jump to the injured health state. However, if the survivor is injured, by default, there is no change in health state. If the trapper is around a trapped survivor, they have a choice. Since the survivor is injured, should the trapper swing at the survivor, that would put them into the dying state, releasing the survivor from the trap, closing the trap, and making the survivor fall to the ground. The trapper can also pick up the survivor without putting them into the dying state. The trap will close, and the survivor will begin to be carried by the trapper. You have 3 seconds where you can wander around on top of your own trap that you've just placed without it catching you in it. Yes, you can catch yourself in your own trap. This will stop you in that location for a few seconds and cause you to go through an animation of untrapping yourself. The trap will still be set whenever you leave it though. Now, a couple of notes for the traps. Most people don't know this, but the setting of the trap is broken into 3 phases. Crouching to place the trap, the actual setting of the trap, and then standing up. This middle section, the setting period, which is approximately 1.5 seconds by default, is the only part affected by add-ons that increase setting speed. Traps cannot be placed within 1.5 meters of each other. And there's a 16 to 17% chance of a survivor escaping a trap, and after 6 escape attempts, it's always a success. And finally, it takes 3.5 seconds for survivors to disarm traps by default. I went ahead and I logged in attributes in this section just because of the fact that he is the most bare-bones killer in my opinion. He's a normal speed killer, walking at 4.6 ms, or 150% movement speed, 15% faster than survivors. He also has a normal terror radius of 32 meters. And he is a tall killer. Tall killers have different pickup animations than short killers and can see over smaller loop objects. In my opinion, he is the most bare-bones killer, and that's all there is. Now that we're at the teachable section is where we really get into how simple Trapper and his perks really are. Whereas now we have killers with hexes, obsessions, and aura rating, Trapper's perks can be broken down very easily. In fact, if I were to break them all down into one single sentence, it would be, Machete Man is scary, strong, and fast. Unnerving presence. Survivors in your terror radius trigger skill checks more often, and the success zones for the checks are reduced. Brutal Strength allows you to break pallets, breakable walls, and to damage generators faster. And Agitation. Move faster while carrying survivors and increase your terror radius while doing so. See? Easy. Now we're in the build section of the guide. So I'm going to give you 4 builds. The first build will be without any teachable perks. If you're pretty new and want to play Trapper, this will be the build you want to go for. 2 following builds after that will be geared towards what you should start working towards after you have started experiencing more of the game. And the last build is Forbidden. You'll see why. So this build has no teachable perks, meaning you don't need to level up any of the killers in order to get these perks and use this build. The perks here are Brutal Strength, Agitation, Slavin Butcher, and whispers. You'll notice that 3/4 of these perks, in a way, speed something up or slow something down. Brutal Strikes increases gen, palate, and wall kick speed, and Agitation increases our movement speed while carrying a survivor, as said before. Sloppy Butcher applies two status effects on survivors whenever you hit them with a regular attack. The first one is Hemorrhage. This causes the survivor to bleed more. And the second is Mangled. This reduces how fast the survivor can be healed. Sloppy Butcher is applied until a survivor is fully healed. This can dissuade some survivors from healing at all, and buys you some much needed time if they do decide to heal. Whispers is the only perk that doesn't have an effect on the speed of the game. Whispers is a tracking perk. Whenever you're within a certain distance of a survivor, Whispers activates. While Whispers is activated, the entity will whisper sweet nothings into your ear to spur you on towards catching your prey. However, if you can't focus on the entity's sweet little voice, the perk will also line up for you. The point of this build is to buy you as much time as possible. Since Trapper revolves around setting up traps for unaware survivors, if generators are flying by while you're trying to do so, it becomes much harder to set up a zone for you to defend later on. Being able to hook and kick faster will buy you more time in chases, so you can then apply your sloppy butcher and go back to setting up. And Whispers gives you two different sets of information. First, if it's active, you know a survivor is nearby and where you should patrol in order to really start applying pressure. And second, if Whispers is off, you'll know that there's no survivors in your vicinity, so you can use a couple seconds to sneak some traps into the area for later. After running by this build with other people, some have recommended no one escapes death instead of Whispers, due to the surprise factor at the end of the game and the fact that lower rank survivors don't often break guns. However, I feel like Noed can stunt a bunny killer's growth due to reliance. I see some rank 1 killers who still have to rely on this perk due to not having experience with proper generator control. As such, I simply can't recommend it for a new killer myself, but there's the information if you want it. The second build has Teachable perks, which are perks that you learn from other killers after a certain level in their blood web. You have to unlock the Teachable perk in their blood web in order to use it on other killers. Okay, this build is oriented around area control, and I'll be using this 3-gen, which are the 3 generators closest together on the map. Whenever you enter a trial, survivors must complete 5 generators to escape. There are 7 generators total, which means when there's 1 gen remaining for the survivors to complete, there's 3 around the map. This is your key situation. Usually you'd have some pressure and a bunch of traps around your recommended territory. The 3-gen. After setting up, you can focus on keeping survivors away from this area and forcing them to complete other generators due to them being too attractive not to complete. And by applying pressure to the generators outside of your 3-gen, forcing them into your trapped area as well, so it's really a win-win. The perks here are Corrupt Intervention from the Plague, learned at level 30, Pop Goes the Weasel from the Clown, learned at level 40, Save the Best for Last from the Shade, learned at level 30, and the last perk can be a perk of your choice. However, I recommend Barbecue and Chili from the Leatherface, which is learned at level 35. Now I'm going to go on ahead and break down each of these perks so you can understand why they're so strong on the killer in the first place. I feel like Corrupt Intervention is one of the strongest and most vital area control perks and slowdown perks for the Trapper due to its effect. Corrupt Intervention blocks the 3 furthest generators from you at the start of the trial. The blocked generators will be highlighted in white, and the perk will be ticking down so you know how much time the gens will be blocked for. This will give you time to set up traps and forces the survivors to come towards you if they want to complete the gens, which means they're coming right into the trap zone. The fear of traps can often deter survivors from this area altogether. Since the furthest gens are blocked, and they're not wanting to come towards you for fear of traps, this can buy you a lot of time since the survivors won't be doing anything. Pop Goes the Weasel allows you to regress a generator by a percentage of its current completion when you damage it within a certain time after you hook a survivor. Keeping track of generator progress will make this perk invaluable in slowing down the survivors since you can nullify a lot of the survivor's work with a single perk. Save the Best for Last is a token perk, a perk that ramps up or down depending on which conditions are being met. With this perk, hitting a survivor who's not the obsession, identified by the entity's tentacles around the survivor portrait, will give you a token, up to 8 total tokens. Each token reduces the attack recovery cooldown from a successful attack. Another perk that will buy you a lot of time if you play well. However, be careful, you lose tokens upon hitting the obsession, Don't lose your momentum just because you think you can get ahead. With this perk, it's always best to try to force the obsession to step in a trap, so you pick them up and not have to risk any tokens you've accumulated by hitting them. But if that's not possible, don't just let the obsession play for free. Apply as much pressure as possible, and kill them if you can. As stated before, the last perk can be one of your own choice, but I recommend Barbecue and Chili. Barbecue and Chili grants you bonus blood points for every unique survivor you hook, up to 100% of extra blood points. But the real delight is that after hooking a survivor, every survivor outside of 40 meters from you is revealed to you for a short time. You can use this in order to find out where you need to keep pressure and sneak some traps around places where survivors seem to be high traffic, giving you a lot of momentum to keep up the pressure. Okay, now for the third build. Third build also has teachable perks. This build plays completely different in comparison to its control-oriented counterpart. And this build is the Chaser Trapper. Very few people run this build, which I think is a shame, but I love it to pieces, due to most survivors not expecting it and making for some really hilarious moments where you catch survivors completely off guard. I will be honest, don't run this build with the expectation of consistent success. The previous build is much more oriented toward the Trapper's recommended playstyle. Heck, even the first build is more oriented around the way the Trapper is recommended to be playing. But if you're looking for some fun where you can give the survivor some real oh no moments, run this. Okay, so the perks for this build are Enduring from the Hillbilly at level 30, Spirit Fury from the Spirit at level 30, Save the Best for Last from the Shape at level 30, Play with Your Food from the Shape at level 35, and I wanted to make sure that you knew you should probably swap out Play with Your Food for Hex Ruin from the Hag if you actually do want to start winning games. Alrighty, I'm going to go through the perks one at a time as usual and tell you exactly what to do. So the first perk, which is Enduring, reduces the duration in which you're stunned by a pallet. That's it. You're stunned less. This buys you time and chases and lets you break the pallet or set up new chase traps on the pallet to force the survivor away. Spare Fury is the crown jewel of this perk build. Paired with Enduring is the real thing that makes you feel like a walking juggernaut that looks at a survivor with glowing red eyes when you're in a chase. After breaking a few pallets, Spirit Fury will activate. When it's activated, the next time you would be stunned by a pallet, the pallet is immediately broken, but you're still stunned. Pairing this with Enduring that reduces the stun duration, and you come out of the stun so fast that the survivor has no time to make any space or do anything. It's hilarious, and one of my favorite mechanics to mess around with. Now, I talked about Save the Best for Last in the last build, so make sure you watch that one if you want to know what this perk does. Okay, now Play with Your Food is another obsession perk. If you lose the obsession in a chase, you get a stack that increases your base movement speed. You can have up to 3 tokens. Once you're at 3 tokens, your base movement speed is increased by 15%. This brings your movement speed to 5.3 ms. You're basically giving the trapper healies. It's awesome. Just be aware that you lose a token upon hitting any survivor. Okay, like I said before, you might want to switch out Play with Your Food for Hex Ruin if you actually want to start winning games. If you'd rather slow the game down and have a better chance at winning, I suggest, of course, Hex Ruin. A Hex perk is tethered to totems that spawn randomly around the map. Whenever a Hex totem is cleansed, if it was powered, the related Hex perk is removed from the killer's arsenal for the rest of the trial. Hex Ruin begins regressing any generator that a survivor stops working on so long as the totem is powered. Since you're oriented around chases instead of setting up, this can give you a lot of pressure, especially since you can trap your Hex totem in order to keep it alive longer. Usually I wouldn't include this silly build like this in a guide, but I have way too much fun with it for not to get an honorable mention. Now for the build, which should not be named. The Forbidden Trapper Technique, passed down from history for so long, it preludes Sun Tzu's Art of War. I mean, not really, but still, this build is really evil. That build is the Basement Trapper. Basement Trapper is oriented around keeping survivors in the basement and preventing them from being able to escape. The perk build for this is Agitation from the Trapper, Iron Grasp, which is a general killer perk, Monster Shrine, another general killer perk, and the last perk can be either Whispers, which is yet another general killer perk, or Lethal Pursuer from Nemesis. Alright, let's go through the perks again. As explained in the Teachables area, Agitation allows you to move faster while you're carrying a survivor. This helps you get this survivor to the basement. Iron Grasp is also pretty simple. Iron Grasp grasp increases how long it takes for a survivor to wiggle free from your grasp, which just gives you more time to get to the basement. The monster's shrine buffs the basement hooks, making any survivor on a basement hook die faster, makes it harder for them to free themselves from the hook, and makes attempting to free themselves from the hook more taxing. Whispers was explained earlier in the first build. In this build, it's used to find a survivor or survivors as quickly as possible in order to get them to the basement. You can use Lethal Pursuer for the same effect, as it reveals survivor auras at the beginning of a trial. However, Whispers works for the entire trial, not just the start. And since some survivors might completely avoid the basement due to knowing what you're up to, it might be better to run Whispers on this build so you can find survivors around the mid-game as well. Now that we've seen the newbie-friendly, the meta, the fun, and the forbidden perk build, let's go ahead and get into the best add-ons and maps for the Trapper. Okay, first, let's talk about add-ons. Anything that increases the amount of traps is immediately amazing. So the Trapper Sack, Trapper Bag, and Stitch Bag are really, really high on the list. Trapper Sack allows you to immediately start with two traps and carry two traps. Trapper Bag lets you start with two traps and carry three traps. And Stitched Bag lets you start with three traps and carry three traps. The next best add-ons, in my opinions, are the ones that increase setting speed. This is because of the time saved. So the Trapper Gloves, Trap Setters, Setting Tools, and Fastening Tools are all very good for this. Trapper Gloves and Trap Setters only increase the speed at which you set traps. The Setting Tools increase setting speed and increase how long it takes for a survivor to escape a trap and be held free from a trap. And the Fastening Tools do all of this and reduce the chances of a survivor being freed from a trap overall. Now we have two add-ons that help somewhat, but I believe are less impactful than the previous ones under most conditions. And those are the Long Wood Die and Tar Bottle. These two add-ons darken the traps, which isn't inherently good, but paired with the right conditions in terms of dark floors, they can be very strong. They're particularly useful on indoor maps, where hiding traps can be difficult, so keep them in mind if you find an indoor map offering in a blowout. The next two add-ons are very popular, and they're the Honing Stone and Iridescent Stone. I like them both, but favor the Iridescent Stone myself. The Honing Stone will put a survivor into the dying state if they free themselves from a trap. This is very powerful, since catching a number of survivors in a trap and not being nearby can be detrimental. If they're forced to either stay in the trap or free themselves of the dying state to call for safety, they can't put any more pressure on the map. And if another survivor comes to help them, that means two survivors are now not doing the objective. The Iridescent Stone can indefinitely lock down a specific loop if you play a card right. Because it reactivates a random deactivated trap on the map every 30 seconds. You can also use this add-on with Remember Me and Trap an Exit Gate. Remember Me increases how long it takes for the exit gates to be opened by a significant duration. As such, there's a likelihood that a survivor trying to open an exit gate will have a place trap open up underneath them while they're opening the gate. It's really funny. And a lot of people give praise to the Bloody Coil add-on because when a trap is deactivated, if a survivor is healthy, they become injured, so it's almost like they freed themselves from a trap. I do not like this add-on myself because of a few things. If a survivor is injured, there's nothing stopping them from disarming your traps. And if they learn that's what you have, they'll just avoid disarming your traps and instead run around them. Which can, if you don't know that a survivor knows about a trap, waste some of your time trying to use your traps for pressure. Okay, and I think that'll do it for the add-ons. Only because I feel like the rest of the add-ons are very, very middle ground and don't really need to be talked about, mostly because their descriptors are mostly mentioned via the perks or other add-ons that are described in the guide. So let's move on to the maps. Alright, so there's three maps that I want to talk about. The first one is Headfield is one of my favorite travel maps. There's a lot of grass, really narrow borders around the sides of the houses, and the rooms of the porches typically can only be accessed via windows. Trapping the outside of these windows makes them unusable by survivors since they have no way of disabling the traps from their side. Another good trapper map is the McMillan's Groaning Storehouse. The central building typically exits out toward a couple of generators, making moving between gens a very smooth process. There's a lot of corners, and the tiles are decently spread apart, which means that a smart track placement will be heavily rewarded. And then there's rotten fields. I wouldn't necessarily say that it's a good trapper map, but it is really rough for survivors whenever they're playing against a basement trapper. Since the killer shack is completely centered on the map, a survivor's ability to avoid being put in the basement is super duper low. Okay, now let me give you a few tips about looping with Trapper. Trapper doesn't have any means of closing the gap himself. However, he does have a few tricks he can use to force survivors away from favorable situations. My first tip is to not start a loop if you don't have a trap in hand. The reason for this is that a survivor can look at your hand and say that you don't have a trap, and thus will try to pull you away from your territory since they know you've placed the trap. Also, if you have a trap in hand and a survivor reaches a safe pallet, you can place the trap down in the middle of the chase, forcing the survivor away in the middle of the loop. You can also fake putting down a trap in the middle of the loop to scare a survivor away from a particular pallet area. Faking until the animation is almost completed can also trick a survivor into thinking you've placed the trap, which may stop them from going back to that loop in the future. Now we're at placing traps in common loops. Here, I'm going to put up a map. These are maze tiles, the common places where a survivor will try to loop a killer in order to waste their time. The red spots here are places where you can place a trap in order to catch a survivor off guard. You'll notice there's a lot of different places. The reason for this is because some tiles will have shrubbery or lack grass that'll force you to place your traps differently. That's the reason why I said being able to adapt as trapper is so important. And as I said before, don't think this is an end-all be-all guide for trapper. Nothing will beat out good old experience. And don't be afraid to get creative. The less predictable you are with your traps, the more likely you are going to catch a survivor unaware. Now we're nearing the end of the guide, the how to make use of your territory segment. As much as I would love to say that the entire map is your territory, that's just not the case. And spreading yourself too thin is the fastest way to find yourself ripping your hair out over playing trapper. As such, you need to set up your own area and understand your limits. Know how many traps you have, understand where the safest loops are, and take advantage of everything within the zone you decide to make. There are a few things you should do after you've established the area you want to be your territory. First, identify the loops where survivors could waste a lot of your time if they make use of them, and trap them. And you don't even need to trap a pallet or window itself in these areas. You can trap around there too. A great way to make use of your territory is to trap areas where a survivor would run after having used up a loop, or getting trap fake, which is pretending to put down a trap mid-loop, which could end 20-second chase in 5 seconds. Setting up traps and creative spots between loops or in fallback positions for survivors can do a lot of damage. This is your battlefield. Make sure the survivors know that. Also, don't be afraid to bring survivors into your territory intentionally. Got a few traps on the outskirts that you need to grab? Chase a survivor into your territory and hook them there. Then run out to grab those traps. Once you do so, returning to your territory after or before an unhook can cause multiple survivors to be trapped in a web of danger. Thank you guys so much for sticking around for the entire guide. If you liked it, please hit the like button and subscribe for more. I'm not sure which killer is going to be visiting for the guide next, but I can't wait to keep making content for you guys. Love ya! When did you get there? Get the fuck!